DLC will tell Greenwich magistrates tomorrow that Charlton's ground is unsafe. The East Terrace should not be open to the public. Their evidence, these photographs, which show rusting crash barriers, apparently near to collapse. Crumbling concrete, another public danger. And major cracks in exterior walls throughout the east side of the ground. The DLC conclude there is a safety risk to spectators, and they want the courts to support their action.
It's worse than the Heysel Stadium in Brussels. The concrete has rotted and the crash barriers are rusted through.
Charlton are the first club to challenge the GLC's safety recommendations. They argue their East Terrace is safe if they limit the crowd there to 3,000. They wouldn't be interviewed, but suggested the GLC were overreacting.
That's exactly what Bradford City said the day after the tragedy. The reason we're going to the magistrates' courts tomorrow, and we hope that the court will support the GLC's line, is that this is a fundamental issue of public safety, and with a huge crowd expected for the friendly against Liverpool on Wednesday, we would be neglecting our public duty if we didn't go to the courts and ask for the East Terrace to be closed.
Coming so soon after the Brussels tragedy, the GLC believe their use of the Safety of Sports Ground Act is a test case for football. Charlton say, come what may, Wednesday's match goes ahead. This is Graham Miller for Thames News.
Thought that the GLC were overreacting and denied that the East Terrace is a safety hazard. We're now going to Greenwich for a live report from Graham Miller.
The GLC insisted throughout the 2.5 hour long hearing here at the Greenwich Magistrates Court that with the experience of the Brussels tragedy, conditions on the East Terrace at Charlton made it twice as dangerous as those at the Heysel Stadium in Brussels, in which 38 people died. Charlton said their safety certificate, renewed annually by the GLC since 1981, had allowed for 10,000 fans on the terrace, but they'd further reduced that to 3,000 to lessen any risk. But the magistrate said the case was clear. On the evidence, the GLC had been lax in not prosecuting the club in earlier years. The conditions decided that no fans should be allowed onto the East Terrace until repairs are carried out. The case ended a short time ago, and earlier I spoke to Richard Collins, a Charlton Athletic director.
3 months ago, the Greater London Council had sanctioned the use of the terrace for 10,000 people, and there's been no deterioration of the terrace since that time, and to reduce from 10,000 people to no people in such a short period makes no sense or logic to me.
Up to now, we've found a very responsible attitude for other clubs. Charlton is the first one that decided that safety isn't such an important issue. When we asked Fulham to close their stand, they acted very responsibly and closed it. When we asked other clubs to do work, they said, yes, we're not very happy, it's going to cost us a lot of money, but safety is important, we will do it. But Charlton had taken a totally different view, and we were very disappointed with this attitude and very gratified that the court has supported us.
First time in league history, two clubs are to share the same ground. Charlton Athletic will move from their ground, the Valley, to share Crystal Palace's Selhurst Park. The two clubs will stay separate. Today they met at the Valley and Charlton won 3-1 in front of 6,500 fans, their biggest crowd of the season.
The decision to leave the Valley ground after 66 years came as a surprise to many of the Charlton Athletic fans at this afternoon's match. And as they emerged after their 3-1 victory over the team whose home they'll soon be sharing, their anger was apparent.
Do you think people will bother to make the journey down the
road? Yeah, well, so.
When you've been brought up in it, right? Come on, you follow me.
As a Charlton supporter, and I've been coming down here for 20 years, I don't think I'll be making the trip to Crystal Palace.
It's unfortunate, but they've really, most of them, I believe, will understand the sense in sharing grounds at Selhurst Park, a stadium that's in perfect condition, holds about 38,000. It's got a lot of facilities that are not here, and I hope eventually they'll understand it. I think most of them will.
More than 75,000 people. Safety regulations have cut the capacity to just 11,000. Today, Charlton announced they'll share Selhurst Park for 7 years and play their first home game there next month. The supporters' club chairman denounced the move as a disgrace.
The Charlton board are adamant that their move to Selhurst Park is unstoppable. They and Crystal Palace are telling both sets of fans tonight that any plans to block the move will be useless. Britain's first ground-sharing scheme is on. Charlton say this is the reason why. 2 acres at the Valley, behind the West Stand, including car parking, the club's electricity house and more than 20 turnstiles are being reclaimed by the former Charlton chairman Michael Glickston at the end of this month. He's understood to be seeking planning permission to build a hotel or houses on the site. With the East Terrace already closed off due to safety restrictions, Charlton say the cost of repairs and replacing what they'll lose is prohibitive. Crystal Palace's own future at Selhurst was secured with the building of the Sainsbury's Superstore at one end of the ground. But with planning permission apparently dependent on its closure on match days, Charlton may be forced to play their home games on Sundays.
I think we've got four fixtures that clash with Palace's fixture list, and that's very fortunate. And those four will play on the Sunday. We'll play them on the Sunday, and I think Sainsbury's will have to find some solution to their own problems there.
Apart from the disrepair on the East Terrace, the clubs say other facilities at the Valley are equally poor, so much so that they're planning another legal battle that this makes the remainder of their 10-year lease at the Valley invalid.
We'd much prefer to play here, but it just isn't sense, it just isn't on with two very large sections of the ground out of use.
There's nothing that can be done now which will prevent you from leaving here?
Now, nothing. You know, we've tried with the Greenwich Council. We've made an offer to buy the land off the freeholders, and that didn't work. And we can't deal with two court orders and still bat on an impossible wicket.
Charlton now plan to buy half the Selhurst Park freehold as soon as possible to make themselves equal partners and to end any doubts about loss of identity. And they're certain that after 66 years of playing at the Valley, during which time 60,000 crowds became commonplace, that their very last fixture here will be against Stoke City, and that's in 11 days' time. Now, the official Charlton Supporters Club has now accepted the unique ground-sharing scheme with Crystal Palace, but everyone in the Valley is expecting a peaceful protest on Saturday. Banners, rosettes, the odd chant. But it's after the game that the real emotions will show. The Valley, September the 19th, 1985. Business as usual for the players as they train for Saturday's game. It's history in the making. In 2 days' time, they'll be gone for good. Many fans likening the final whistle to the last post. The message from the directors has been clear. If Charlton don't leave, the club will die. Sharing Selhurst Park gives the fans and players a new chance.
They deserve the opportunity to prove that they are as good or even better, greater than the ghosts of the past. They deserve those opportunities. If we stay here, I don't think that could happen because the club is surely done.
The Charlton boardroom, where the club has lurched from crisis to crisis, will close for good on Saturday night. Like its memories, the old photos will travel to Selhurst Park, the cup final team, the great Sam Bartram, marvellous teams from the past. They'll all have to fight for space at their new home. The fans say it'll never be the same again.
It'll never be the same as the Valley. The Valley, as I've seen it throughout the years, with packed crowds, really packed, when there was only dirt terracing over there.
Come Saturday, everyone will have a different memory. Take former manager Mike Bailey.
I won my two England caps here, and I managed here, and we got promotion to the second division. You know, many happy memories, and I expect they'll all go through my mind.
Can you believe it?
Not really, no. It's it won't seem the same.
Officially, the move is unstoppable, but behind the scenes, the fight to stay continues. Greenwich Council, the local MP, various pressure groups, all have pledged to finding a new home in the area, but time is running out. Every Charlton fan now knows what's going to happen, but I wonder how many really believe it.
I'm still hopeful that a solution will be found with the Greenwich Council, Sunlis and Glickstein.
So in your heart of hearts, you think they'll stay?
I don't think they'll stay at this stage, but I'm hopeful that they will eventually come back home to the Valley.
The last game at the Valley was marred by a demonstration by fans at half-time. Several hundred supporters invaded the pitch, chanting slogans against the move by Charlton to Crystal Palace's ground. Police eventually cleared the pitch. About 9,000 people were there to see the match against Stoke.
Yeah. Come on, referee, show this time out.
Years at the Valley, Charlton are moving to Selhurst Park because of the condition of their ground. But at least Charlton finished at the Valley with a win. They beat Stoke 2-0. After the match, fans moved back onto the pitch and many took away portions of the turf as a memento of Charlton's days at the Valley.
Charlton's fans laid a wreath on the centre spot before the last game at the Valley ground. The team beat Stoke 2-0. But at the end, angry supporters invaded the pitch to protest against the club's move to Crystal Palace. From now on, Charlton will share the facilities at Selhurst Park, 6 miles away. But today, the fans said the team would be travelling without them. The best crowd of the season, almost 9,000, watched the last 90 minutes of the Valley's 66-year history, 80,000 fewer than the ground record, and several hundred took a few memories home.